Good morning. We have another guest speaker this morning. Comes because of the Paduano Lecture Series, again, that deals with moral, ethical, and spiritual principles. And it's a generous endowed fund, enables us to bring all kinds of speakers to Taft. So we're grateful to the Paduano family for that. I discovered the guest speaker today reading articles on truthout.org. There's a clearinghouse where there are many articles from scholars and professors from around the world. You know, it's very hard to get real news on the mainstream media, so you've got to be use your analytical, critical mind and look around many different sources out there to really find out what's going on, you know, locally, nationally, globally. But I want to introduce our guest speaker. And the reason he's here, I have an AP Human Geography class, and there's some students who are out here. And we're reading a book. It's called Half the Sky, and Half the Sky is held up by women. And the writer Nicholas Kristof from the New York Times and his wife Cheryl Wu Dunn, both write for the New York Times, make the case that probably the seminal moral challenge of our time is gender inequality. And with that goes the oppression of women globally, particularly in developing countries, but we also have issues in developed countries. And with that goes human trafficking. So our guest speaker will tie in nicely to our summer reading in AP Human Geo. But he'll also be around campus today if you want to talk to him further. So our guest speaker today is Jeff McCord, a former U.S. Senate legislative aide and freelance journalist for Dow Jones International Publications, including the Wall Street Journal. He is a contributor to the political zine Truthout and the author of the well-regarded novel Undocumented Visitors in a Pirate Sea that takes place in the Caribbean Sea. Now you might want to read it since a lot of you go vacation there in the Caribbean. Jeff was a double major in history and economics at American University in Washington, D.C., and did his postgraduate studies in economics at the London School of Economics and George Washington University. He is particularly interested in the politics of economics and world trade. So let us warmly welcome Mr. Jeff McCord.
Thanks very much. It's a real pleasure and privilege to be here today, and I'm only sorry, I don't know how to put, oh, there we go. All right. I'm only sorry that it's such a beautiful campus and such a beautiful region of the world. I have to speak about such a distressing topic. And while most of us focus daily on terrorism and the ongoing wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, there is another horror playing out on a daily basis, and playing out quietly and to most people in the United States unobserved, and it is occurring day after day, year after year, and that is human trafficking, which many people, including myself, are now calling the worst manifestation what it really is, slavery. And a very good example of how this affects all of us, all of you, and a way to sort of understand what this means is to look at one industry that in which this practice is unfortunately widespread, and that is the seafood industry. And these practices take place in every major Asian seafood producer in the world, sadly. But let's get a little historical perspective. I'm sure you have read, required to read, hopefully, Uncle Tom's Cabin. I understand Harriet Beecher Stowe grew up right down the road. And many of you have probably seen the movie 12 Years a Slave. You have a good idea of what slavery was like in the United States before the Civil War. And you may think that slavery ended back then after the war. This photo of two slave children was taken in North Carolina in the 1850s. You may also think that the Civil War ended the sale of humans as slaves, and this is an auction probably in, I think it's in Washington, D.C., actually, the capital, which shows you how widespread and egregious this practice was in the states. But sadly, you'd be wrong. Slavery is alive and well today, possibly with more slaves than ever in history. Estimates are between 20 and 30 million people are living as slaves, and many of them work in Asia. And at least 5.5 million slaves are children, and that number is probably quite small. Bob mentioned the problem with women, and sadly, women are often targeted and go unnoticed by the few non-governmental agencies and the UN that are trying to get a handle on this problem. Now, how could this happen? It's simple. Labor procurers go to villages in remote, often in remote areas in Asia and in Africa, and offer young people, and it's mostly young people they want. They're strong, they have a future of a longer working life, and they offer young people like these good paying jobs in cities. They're promised exciting new lives in cities like Bangkok, which, as you all know, is the capital of Thailand. But when they are transported from their villages, men with guns take away their identity papers, if they have them, and passports, if they have them, and literally lock them up in rooms such as this. This is a photograph from a recent National Geographic article on modern slavery. And then they are sold to various businesses. And some are sent to work on fishing boats, fish farms, and in seafood processing plants in Asian nations, including Thailand. And I don't mean to pick on Thailand, but Thailand recently was, its human rights status was recently downgraded by the U.S. Department of State. And it's now on a level with North Korea and Iran. Now, why is Thailand relying on slaves? Well, there is a labor shortage. Thailand, as in China and Vietnam, they are rapidly industrializing. Many of the people in their own countries have flocked to the cities to find industrial works, left the farms, left the rural areas where, of course, seafood farms and fishing villages are located. And so there is a labor shortage, and in the case of Thailand, many of the people that are recruited into slavery come from the neighboring country of Myanmar, which us older folks know as Burma. And just the scenario I painted, they're promised jobs and they arrive and they're enslaved. And the largest seafood producing Asian nations all do use forced labor, and this isn't me speaking, this is the U.S. Department of State, which every year puts out a report on human trafficking, and this year's report came out in June, and they have included Thailand, China, Vietnam, and Malaysia, which are the four largest seafood producing nations. Well, except with the exception of India, but among the largest in Asia, they are among the largest exporters of food, seafood to the United States, and they are all at fault, and in each case, the governments have not been enforcing a level of basic human rights. And sadly, 90% of the seafood we all eat is imported, and most of that comes from Asia. And China is the largest supplier of a increasingly popular fish called tilapia. It is the largest exporter of tilapia to the United States, and all the tilapia we eat is imported. Same thing with shrimp and other warm water-sourced fish. If you eat it and it came from one of those nations, it was very likely produced with slave labor. And this photo illustrates how in the processing plants the work is done very laboriously by hand, whereas in American fish processing plants it's automated. Now, just how bad are these conditions, and why am I actually calling it slavery? Well, there is an organization, a non-governmental organization called Fishwise, which studies and promotes sustainable seafood practices. And in a study they released in April or May, they said, quote, "The recruiting and working conditions of many Asian fishers and seafood industry employees are so egregious that these human and labor rights abuses have been referred to as modern slavery." And that's what it is. When you're forced to work at little or no pay, there's no other word for it. And the conditions could hardly be worse, and probably even worse than in the American South before the Civil War. In fact, in one survey by a London-based non-governmental organization, Thai seafood workers reported seeing, half of the seafood reporters reported workers reported seeing laborers actually murdered on the job, workers murdered. And with given these conditions, there is a significant amount of suicide among workers. Now, why would an employer murder its workers? Well, the sad truth is that human slaves are far cheaper today than they were even 200 years ago. Using today's dollars, inflation adjusted, in 1809, a slave cost $40,000. Now, that was a significant investment. That was a significant asset, and one worth, at the very least, giving basic care and paying attention to minimal degree health and welfare. However, today, humans only cost $90 a piece. I mean, that is remarkable. And so these unscrupulous business owners may well feel that people are so cheap that if they beat and murder some, that it's worth it to keep the others in line. So this may make some business sense to these unscrupulous people. It's a sad case of economics. In fact, today, these industries do view slaves as disposable economic inputs. And as I said, by comparison, 200 years ago, when they were, I'm not a mathematics whiz, but, hundreds of times more valuable, they would have been treated somewhat better. Now, why does slavery continue, and why don't governments stop it? Well, as in so much in life, the unfortunate answer is money. And $150 billion a year in profits is estimated, and that's probably a low estimate. That comes from the International Labor Organization. $150 billion in profits worldwide each year come from forced labor. And many local governments are corrupt and paid by slavers to keep quiet as they bring these people across borders to there have been a couple of documented instances, and it probably happens routinely. Police, in this case it was Thailand, actually returned runaway slaves to their owners, and this was in the seafood industry. And before we think, oh, isn't that awful, let's and it is terrible, let's also keep in mind that in the United States, before the Civil War, we had a horrendous law called the Fugitive Slave Act, which required people to return runaway slaves to bondage in the South. Now, I don't want to be picking on this one industry, but again, I think it is a way for us to really get a handle on this, since we eat the produce of these people. But it's not the only industry that uses slaves. In Africa, for example, slaves are used to mine gold, diamonds, and other valuable minerals. And many of you may have seen, if you haven't, you should watch it, a great movie called Blood Diamonds with Leonardo DiCaprio, and he goes into this in detail. Now, what can we do? Well, we all have to get more active in politics, and we should be, and someday, hopefully, or maybe you do, schools, classes in schools like Taft and in public schools, you know, should be writing to members, your local members of Congress, your senators, the president, telling them to put strong human rights provisions in all U.S. trade agreements. Now, this is a current and important issue. There is now on a so-called fast track a free trade agreement called the Trans-Pacific Trade Treaty that would allow free and unfettered, you know, open trade between all of these countries of the Pacific Rim. And there are some requirements for labor rights, but sadly, some of the Asian countries we mentioned have already, and this including Vietnam, have already told us that they will not adhere to the minimum human rights standards in this treaty. So it's a question, will Congress and the President move forward despite this horrible human rights situation, and also because arguably there are economic problems to American workers and consumers with these agreements, or not? So this is an excellent time to contact Congress. Another thing, it perhaps goes without saying, and this is a bit old-fashioned, but people can, and in my opinion, should buy Made in America products whenever they're available. Because if U.S. demand, for example, Asian seafood, declines, then the need for the perceived need for the producers to use slave labor will also decline. And so I would argue that there should be a boycott of these products. And there may be people in Washington that are thinking along other people that are thinking along those lines. Also, we should write letters to editors of newspapers and television stations asking them to report on this horrendous practice so that more Americans will learn about it. And this is key. I know from my travels and talks with people that very few people are aware that there are between 20 and 30 people living as slaves today in the world, and that American consumers are fed and sold their products made with slaves every day. Now, I'm happy to take questions. I don't know how much time I have. But one thing I want to, if any of you are interested in learning more about this, an easy accessible source is CNN has a Freedom Project in which they have been reporting continuously on the problem of slavery, and they have a lot of statistics and quote some of the sources I've quoted in my talk. And so I would urge you all to take a look at that if you have time. I know they keep you real busy here, and that's a great thing. It's a great school. But this is an area that could and should be of interest. With that, I appreciate your attention and enjoy being here today. It's a beautiful school, great school, beautiful countryside, and it's a real pleasure.